All right. So, in this video, let us talk about another local maximum power point tracking algorithm, which is called as the perturb and observe method. Right. This is like one of the most intuitive way of finding the local maxima. So let us see how this algorithm works in case of solar photovoltaic. So for solar photovoltaic, we do have power versus voltage graph, which looks something like this, right? And now, if you see, if let's say I've connected this panel through DC to DC converter to a battery. As we understand, by controlling the duty cycle, I can generate variable voltage across PV, right? VPV I can control by controlling the duty cycle. Why? Because V battery is fixed. So if I change the duty cycle, the output to input ratio changes and thus the VPV changes, right? So for example, if this is the value of VPV where I'm operating at this instant. What I can do is I can just randomly increase it to a value VPV2, right? And then observe if the power has increased or reduced. If the power has increased, that implies I'm moving in the correct direction. So I can further increase it. I can further increase it. And at one point, I will see that the power is reducing from the previous instant, right? So if you see from moving from 3 to 4, the power has reduced. That implies I'm trying to move away from the maximum power point. So in that case, the algorithm can bring it back, right? You start going back. Then if you go take one step, you will see power has increased. You take another step, you will see power has reduced. So that means again you are going in the wrong direction. So you again come back. And finally, we would just oscillate around the peak power point or the MPP point. Right? It's very intuitive. It's also called as perturb and observe. But it's also called as hill climbing method, right? Because it sort of looks like a hill and we are trying to climb the hill. So, how do we write it? Let's say if you want to write in terms of an algorithm, you want to do a digital implementation, then in a very simple way, this is how we can create the flowchart for this particular method. So let's say you define certain parameters, direction, which essentially means whether to move right or left. So one is for right. Let's say I initialize the direction parameter to one. Right now, in each step, how much voltage do I want to increase? So let me define a value of delta V. Right, and maybe let's say I define the initial value of panel voltage reference to something. Right, so this is the initialization part. After the initialization part, the first thing I can do is I can increase the voltage VPV ref is equal to VPV ref plus DIR, which is one of the variable, multiplied by delta V. Right? So let's say I increase the voltage as first step. And DIR is 1, so 1 multiplied by delta V is delta V, so I increase the voltage. So I'm going, let's say, from 0.1 to 0.2. Now, once you have given this command to increase, this command will go to the converter, right? Accordingly, duty cycle will get adjusted such that you get the PV voltage equal to the desired voltage, right? So, for instance, there may be a closed loop control operating and so on. So, therefore, we then wait for some time. Let's call it TS. And after that, we check how is the power new as compared to power old. So in the initialization, let me also define two more parameters, pnew and pold. You can initialize them with certain value and we'll see how they get updated as we move along in the algorithm. So if the new power, maybe we can add one more step here before we do this comparison. We wait for some time and then we measure the new power, right, which is the power at this instant, and then we make this comparison. So if the new power is greater than old power, that means whatever I'm doing is perfectly fine, right? Nothing is required. I'm doing okay. I'm moving in the right direction. But if the answer to this is no, that means I'm going in the wrong direction. So what I should do is I should change the direction. So I should make direction is equal to minus times direction. So if I was moving from left to right, I should move from right to left. And if I was earlier moving from right to left, I should move from left to right. Right. And that's it. And what else you can do? You can save, you can update the old now and feed the new power into the old power resistor so that for the next comparison, you have this instant power. And go back and they repeat this step. And this sort of pretty much sums up the algorithm. Unlike the incremental conductance method which we saw, the perturb and observe method never sort of settles to the peak value, right? It always continues to oscillate because either you are going right or you are going left. If you see this algorithm, either you are moving towards life or you are moving towards left. Right, continuously, and even when it settles, it sort of oscillates around the peak point, right? So this is one of the limitations, although there are variations of the basic method and so on to take care of this issue. Right, now with this basic method, if you see, there are three things I would like to discuss about which are important when you practically try to implement this method. So those three things are, two of them are the variable. So how do we choose the value of TS, right? And how do we choose the value of delta V? These are two of the concerns, right? So how do we select TS and how do we select delta V? And the third concern is how do we measure this power pnew, right? So how do we measure pnew? These are the three concerns. Let's have a quick discussion around each of these points. So if this is the P versus V graph, right, and I start from here V1, then if I have a smaller TS, small value of TS, that means I will be updating after a lot of time, right? So I would reach the peak, but it will take last time for me to reach the if I have smaller TS, that means I'm updating pretty fast and therefore I will be able to reach the peak very fast, right? So you can say fast tracking, right? Even if suddenly solar radiation changes, right, and if your or the temperature changes and your peak power changes, for example, comes here, you will very quickly move to the next one. Right, so that is the advantage of a smaller wait period TS. But the problem is, as I told you before, once you give this reference voltage command to the power electronic converter, then usually converter would have its own inner voltage and current loops, right? And converter would also have LC filters and so on. So it takes a finite amount of time for all of those systems to get settled, right? And therefore we cannot really make this TS very, very small. Moreover, as we see, this measurement of new block also takes some time, which effectively adds to this total effective TS. So TS is, we would like TS to be as small as possible, but TS is usually limited by response time of, I will call it system, right, which essentially includes the converter and the control, and it is also limited by the measurement time, right, or the measurement process. I will talk about it just in a little bit of time when we talk about how to measure P nu. So you have to choose a suitable value of TS such that you fall somewhere in between. Usually, if you see, usually TS would lie somewhere, maybe, I'm talking about effective TS, which is the total time, which is the wait time plus the time required to calculate P nu, right? Let me call it as effective TS effective. So usually this TS effective value could be somewhere between 100 milli to a second. Right, so your algorithm actually repeats after every 100 millisecond to 1 second, depending on these two requirements. And obviously, you would like to keep a smaller value for faster tracking. In fact, there is one more phenomena which is kind of an extreme case which can happen if your TS is actually large. Let me try to demonstrate that phenomena to you. So let's say this is P versus V graph. Right, and at this stage I'm operating somewhere here A, and now my algorithm increases the voltage and I reach point B. Right, ideally while going from A to B, the power will reduce and therefore the next step would be to come back to point A. But imagine a scenario wherein while we are going from A to B, suddenly the solar radiation has changed. The solar radiation has changed, so at voltage this power has actually increased. So at A I was at A point, now instead of landing at B, because by the time I came to B the solar radiation changed and I landed at point P prime. So now I will see power has increased. So what will the controller do? Controller will feel that we are moving in the right direction. It will further try to move on the right hand side. Now let's say when further it tries to move on the right hand side, further the power has increased, right? Although it was moving from B prime to C prime, it actually ended up at C double prime. And then again from B prime to C prime, it will see that power has gone up, right? If you draw horizontal line and see what is B prime, C prime, you would again see the power has gone up. So by doing so, what is happening? If the solar radiation is changing faster than TS, right, then you may be actually deviating from the maximum power point, and eventually let's say you may land up somewhere, this diagram is not very well drawn, but you may land up quite far away. For example, the situation could be that you have reached to, for example, somewhere here. Now the algorithm, obviously once the system settles, the algorithm would realize that, oh, I've actually gone quite far away. And then again, it will do one step here whenever the system settles and find that the power is negative. So it will again start coming back and it will eventually come back to the peak. But the time it will take, for example, it to come back, you are losing the power, right? You could have had, let's say, 100 watt of power in this process. If you are operating at peak, but here let's say you are operating at 10 watt, so coming from 10 watt to 100 watt, you are losing power. So that is one problem. The other problem could be that you imagine a situation where radiation is continuously changing, right, and changing much faster than TS. So in that scenario, this phenomena could probably be continue to have, right, it never settles. So you are always operating somewhere far away. And therefore, it is desired to have a small value of TS. Alright, this was one thing. Now let us pick up the second thing, which is the parameter delta V, right? How do we select the value of parameter delta V? So if I again draw P versus V graph, then you can see that if I start from here, right, delta V is the essentially the step I take, right? So larger the value of delta V implies you will reach the peak point much faster. But then once you reach the peak point, you will again have larger steps on both sides. And larger steps means if this is P1, this would be P2. Farther is the step delta V, lower would be the value of P2. And therefore, the larger V2 would also imply less effective tracking. When I say effective tracking, essentially what I mean is that now you have reached the top, right? But you are not actually getting continuous P1. You are still getting a combination of P1 plus P2 because you are oscillating between these points. So if P2 is less than P1, then the average power that you will get is going to be less than P1. So if you had a smaller step, you would had, let's say, something very close to P1, maybe let's call it P3, right? Which would have been a better situation. So larger delta V certainly helps you reach the position fast. But then because the system oscillates, it does not really help when the system reaches to that value. There are quite a few variations. You can sort of adaptively change the value of delta V and so on. So we are not going into that, but just the basic sense of what is the pros and cons of selecting a larger or a smaller value of delta V. Third thing, P nu calculation, right? How do we calculate P nu? Or the power measurement, let me just call it power measurement. Right, how do I measure power? So if you see what we want to do to measure power, you have voltage, you have current, you will multiply voltage and current and you will get power, right? Seems very simple and seems very straightforward. But what happens is the voltage will have noise pickup due to converter operation and so on. Current might also have noise pickup due to operation. Your measurement circuits might have noises, right? Your system might be intransient and so on. And therefore, you do not just pick one value of V and multiply with one instantaneous value of I. But what you do is you find the average of V into I over a period of time, right? So usually you take a substantial period so that the oscillations or the error generated due to noise pickup, etc. goes away and you actually get a real value of power. And this adds to the TS value, right? So that is why I was saying, if you see TS effective is actually the combination of TS plus the time for measurement, right? So time for measurement includes gathering large number of samples and then finding the average, right? So first, when you gather large number of samples, you have to wait for some time and then some processing time to actually find the average of all of those samples, right? So your TS measurement or T measurement could also be substantial, and thus the effective time is the combination of TS and TS T measurement. If you do a MATLAB simulation or something, maybe you can probably keep a very small value of measurement, right? Or not just MATLAB simulation, if you do any simulation where you do not have a noise pickup and so on, you can probably use a very small value of T measurement. The TS would be limited by the converter dynamics and so on, but in practical situation, T measurement could also be substantial. Right? Yeah, that's it. That's the basic overview about the perturb and observe method or hill climbing method.